So these stories of mythology are simply trying to express a truth that can't be grasped any other way.
It's the edge, the interface between what can be known and what is never to be discovered, because it is a mystery transcendent of all human research. The source of life. What is it? No one knows.
Why are stories important for getting at that?
Well, I think it's important to live life with a knowledge of its mystery and of your own mystery. And it gives life a new zest, a new balance, a new harmony to do this. I mean, therapy and psychological therapy, when people find out what it is that's ticking in them, they get straightened out. And what is it that life is? I find thinking in mythological terms has helped people visibly. You can see it happen.
How? What does it do?
It erases anxieties. It puts them in accord with the inevitables of their life, and they can see the positive values of what are the negative aspects of what is positive. It's whether you're going to say no to the serpent or yes to the serpent. As easy as that.
No to the adventure?
Yeah, the adventure of being alive, of living. Psychologically, the dragon is one's own binding of oneself to one's ego, and you're captured in your own dragon cage. And the problem of the psychiatrist is to break that dragon, open him up, so that you can have a larger field of relationships. Jung had a patient come to him who felt alone, and she drew a picture of herself as caught in the rocks. From the waist down, she was bound in rocks. And this was on a windy shore, and the wind blowing and her hair blowing, and all the gold, which is the sign of the vitality of life, was locked in the rocks. Suddenly, a lightning flash hit the rocks, and the gold came pouring out. And then she found reflected on rocks round about the gold, and there was no more gold in the rocks. It was all available on the top. And in the conferences that followed, those patches of gold were identified. They were her friends. She wasn't alone, but she had locked herself in her own little room and life, but she had friends. Do you see what I'm meaning? This is killing the dragon. And you have fears and things. This is the dragon. That's exactly what that's all about. At least the European dragon. Chinese dragon is different.
What is it?
It represents the vitality of the swamps, and the dragon comes out beating his belly and saying, ha, 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 ha. You know, that's another kind of dragon. And he's the one that yields the bounty and the waters and all that kind of thing. He's the great, glorious thing. But this is the negative one that cuts down.
So what you're saying is, if there are not dragons out there, and there may not
be
any...
The real dragon is in you.
And what is that real dragon? And what is that real dragon? And what is that real dragon?
That's your ego holding you in.
What's my ego? What's my ego? What's my ego?
What I want, what I believe, what I can do, what I think I love, and all that. What I regard as the aim of my life and so forth. It might be too small. It might be that which pins you down. And if it's simply that of doing what the environment tells you to do, it certainly is pinning you down. And so the environment is your dragon, as it reflects within yourself.
How do I slay?
How do you
slay that dragon in me? What's the journey I have to make, you have to make, each of us has to make? You talk about something called the soul's high adventure.
My general formula for my students is follow your bliss. I mean, find where it is and don't be afraid to follow it.
Can Can my bliss be my life's love or my life's work? Is it my work or my life?
Well, if the work that you're doing is the work that you chose to do because you are enjoying it, that's it. But if you think, oh, gee, I couldn't do that, you know, that's your dragon that's locking you in. Oh, no, I couldn't be a writer. Oh, no, I couldn't do what so-and-so is doing.
Unlike the classical heroes, we're not going on our journey to save the world, but to save ourselves.
And in doing that, you save the world. I mean, you do. The influence of a vital person vitalizes. The vital person vitalizes. There's no doubt about it. People have the notion of saving the world by shifting it around and changing the rules and so forth. And no, any world is a living world if it's alive. And the thing is to bring it to life. And the way to bring it to life is to find in your own case where your life is and be alive yourself, it seems to me.
You say I have to take that journey and go down there and slay those dragons. Do I have to go alone?
If you have someone who can help you, that's fine too. But ultimately, the last trick has to be done by you.
Hollywood, go. Go. Hey, Hollywood, go. Go. Hollywood, go. Go. Hollywood, go. Go. Hollywood, go. Go. Hollywood, go. Go.
The last trick has to be done by you.
You wanna know just where I'm at? Well, let me tell you about it. I put my city on the map, but let me tell you about it. They try to say I can't come back, hey, let me tell you about it. Hey, let me tell you about it. I wanna tell you about it.
I got loyalty, got royalty inside my DNA. Cocaine quarter piece, got war and peace inside my DNA. I got power, poison, pain, and joy inside my DNA. I got hustle, though ambition flow inside my DNA. I was born like this, and sworn like this, immaculate conception. I transform like this, perform like this, wish y'all shoot a new weapon. I don't contemplate, I meditate, then off your fucking head. This that put the kids to bed, this that I got realness. I just kill shit cause it's in my DNA. I got millions, I got riches building in my DNA. I got dark, I got evil that rot inside my DNA. I got off, I got trouble, some heart inside my DNA. I just win again, then win again like Wimbledon I serve. Yeah, that's him again, the sound, the engine in is like a bird. You see fireworks and Corvette tires skirt the boulevard. I know how you work, I know just who you are. See, and I'm gon' shine like I'm supposed to. Antisocial extrovert, and exit lit mean an extra work. And absentness, what the fuck you hurt? And passiveness never struck my nerve. And that's a riff gonna be this case. The reason my power's here. Salute the truth from the prophet, say. I got loyalty, got royalty inside my DNA. I'm inheriting money and power, the maker emeritus. Tell me something, you motherfuckers can't tell me nothing. I'd rather die than to listen to you. My DNA not for imitation, your DNA an abomination. This how it is when you in the matrix, dodging bullets, reaping what you're sowing, stacking up the footage, going, sleeping in the villa, sipping from a Grammy, walking in the building, diamond in the ceiling, marble on the floors, beaches out the window, peeking out the window, baby in the pool, Godfather calls, only Lord knows.
Not my DNA, dripping gold inside my DNA. Dripping gold inside my DNA. Shows inside my DNA. Dripping gold inside my DNA.
Uh-huh. How do I slay that dragon in me? What's the journey I have to make? You have to make, each of us has to make. You talk about something called a soul's high adventure.
I was walking through icy streams that took my breath away. Moving slowly through westward water over glacial plains, and I walked off you. Walked off and owned me. Owned me, oh my, I thought it was a dream. So it seemed.
Success Corvettes, but I'm all, but why you so sad? Walking around with them blue faces. They say I'm down on my luck and it's on my guy to have blue faces. I hit the bank today and tell them color me bad. Blue faces, getting new money and it's breaking me down. 365 times 4 plus more. Can't get it right, tell me, do you got the stamina? But ain't no money like fast money. Even today I'm considered a crash dummy. A rapper chasing stardom. How can I fast forward my act? You lays better than all them. But why I'm so sad? Walking around with them blue faces. They say I'm down on my luck and it's something I gotta have. Blue faces. I hit the bank today and tell them color me bad. Blue faces. Get it new money and it's breaking me down to the top. I love God, I love speed, I love drink, I love me, I love oceans in the deep, I love women, I love me, I love God, but I'm scared of God's speed sometimes. Then he looked me in the eye and said, homie, you messed up. You're begging on good luck, you're wishing for miracles. Living through issue, crying hysterical. Settle for everything, complaining about everything. Say you're so crack, my world amphetamine. Your projects ain't it, I live in a hut. You're living to keep warm, I'm living to pay rent. I paid my way through, praying to Allah, you played your way through.
dealing with Wi-Fi, pour issues out for talking to strangers. Same thing go for the one she came with. We all came on a boat looking for hope, and all you can say is that you're looking for dope. These days ain't no compromise. Your pain ain't mine's half the time. A brand new excuse ain't nothing to me. See, I did a lot of dumb things in my past. Love will give me hope and I don't relapse. Damn, just bought a new 911. Almost thought I seen another plane crash. You just bought a brand new McLaren. Rock a like a bottle by the projects. Usually got his slow and drooping and glow. Me, I'm about to let my hair down the hoes. Ali about to let his hair down the hoes. Top billing, that's a big in the show. Might blow the whole no web in your soul.
Public service announcement sponsored by Just Blaze and the good folks at Rockefeller Records.
Fellow Americans, it is with the utmost pride and sincerity that I present this recording as a living testament and recollection of history in the making during our generation.
Say the movie, dogs.
Now, before I finish, let me just say, I did not come here to show out. I did not come here to impress you. Because to tell you the truth, when I leave here, I'm gone. And I don't care what you think about me. But just remember, when it hits the fan, brother, whether it's next year, 10 years, 20 years from now, you'll never be able to say that these brothers lied to you, Jack.
Thing ain't lie. I done came through the block and everything that's fly. I'm like Che Guevara with bling on. I'm complex. I never claim to have wings on. I get my by any means on. Whenever there's a drought, get your umbrellas out, because that's when I brainstorm. You can blame Sean, but I ain't inventing the game. I just rolled the dice trying to get some change. And I do it twice, ain't no sense to me lying as if I am a different man. And I could blame my environment, but ain't no reason why I be buying expensive chains. Hope you don't think users are the only abusers getting high within the game. If you do, then how would you explain? I'm 10 years removed, still the vibe is in my veins. I got a hustler spirit, period. Check out my hat, yo, peep the way I wear it. Check out my swag, yo, I walk like a ball player. No matter where you go, you are what you are, player. And you can try to change, but that's just the top layer. Man, you was who you was before you got here. Only God can judge me, so I'm gone. Either love me or leave me alone.
Blue corner, wearing black trunks with gold and trim, hailing from Las Vegas. welcome boxing's future Hall of Famer and undisputed top attraction. Here is the former five division champion of the world, introducing the sensational and undefeated Floyd
Little. My father was famous. He was the greatest samurai in the empire, and he was the shogun's decapitator. He cut off the heads of 131 lords. It was a bad time for the empire. The shogun just stayed inside his castle, and he never came out. People said his brain was infected by devils. My father would come home. He'd forget about the killings. He wasn't scared of the shogun, but the shogun was scared of him. Maybe that was the problem. Then, one night, the shogun sent his ninja spies to our house. They were supposed to kill my father, but they didn't.
I've been told that you were born again, basically, 3 or 4 months ago, that you found a place where, and I'd like you to explain this to me, the toad. I'd like you to explain the toad to me.
Do you understand the toad?
Is it like ayahuasca?
No, it takes you to another level. Ayahuasca is nothing compared to this.
Is it called DMT?
Yes. The toad, and it's in the Sonora Desert, and it has the venom in it. And you smoke it. Once I tried it, boom! Everything just went so fast. When I fell out, the only thing I was conscious, but I was out. My brain was still functioning, my thoughts, I could still talk to myself, I could hear my mind, and I was saying, I fucked up. And I killed myself.
Because you killed
the ego. I'm dying. It was just really mind-blowing.
Spiritual in nature, though,
yeah,
right?
Like really, my whole life totally changed. It sounds like a movie strip, a script, but it's really the real deal.
At that moment, you're talking about like you come to and you are altered. You are altered and it stayed.
I don't know. I wake up, I'm happy, I'm laughing, I'm smiling. I'm saying, what the f-
really
happened? Yeah.
Really?
I had no idea, but it was only 15 minutes, but it felt like hours.
Mm-hmm.
And it was frightening.
Because of that ego thing, because you realize you're small all of a sudden.
Yeah, once I realized that I'm nothing, I realized all my fancy clothes, my big clothes.
Can you explain to me why it makes you emotional just talking about it? Because I imagine the reason it makes you emotional is because for 4 decades you've been trying to find happy, man.
Well, you know, when you think you know everything, then you realize you don't know anything.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big awakening. You can call it growth or you can call it divine intervention.
Can you explain how it changed you?
It was just the death of your ego. Now your ego died. I felt so naked and afraid at that particular time because that's all I really had when you really think about it, was my ego.
That's interesting because your ego served you too, or in some of the ways other people would measure success.
Oh, no doubt, 100%. It made me that guy that I really wasn't interested in as I got older, but that made me a very special and famous person. I never knew what an ego was until he expressed to me what an ego was and how successful, the most successful people have the biggest egos.
I believe he will be the youngest heavyweight champion of all time.
And I just believed what he told me.
And did you realize that your ego was a problem as you were climbing up?
No, my ego gave me everything I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
How could that be a monster? No, my ego gave me everything I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
How could that be a monster?
What was that like to be the youngest heavyweight champion? Did you get to enjoy it? Or was it just pressure, leeches, trust problems, betrayal, that everything that came with money and success after
that? Yeah, but I thought that's what it was. I was groomed to be Goliath. I wasn't groomed to be David. Even though I was small, I was the David guy because I'm smaller than mm-hmm. everybody. But I was groomed to be Goliath because I'm so insecure. I was a monster because that's all I really knew. And that's all I wanted to be because I was the most successful fighter. But the way I was promoted, I'm Goliath, I'm a killer. Nobody's gonna ever feel sorry for me. Goliath, I'm a killer. Nobody's gonna ever feel sorry for me. Goliath, I'm a killer. Nobody's gonna ever feel sorry for me.
We live at a crossroads. There's no doubt. We all feel it. We all know it. I don't think it's the first time that mankind has stood at such a crossroads. But here we are now, facing it and hopefully dealing with it. I'm going to close with a reading from the Hermetica, from the Hermetic texts. Hermes was the Greek version of the ancient Egyptian god Thoth. The Romans knew him as Mercury. And in a dialogue, the Hermetica, many of them are dialogues between Thoth, Hermes, and various pupils of his. And in one called the Asclepius, a lament is presented. And it's like a prophecy. It's a bit like the Mayan prophecy. Egypt seems to stand as a metaphor for the whole world in this, and to my mind, for the world in our time. This lament, this prophecy is speaking directly to us. So it's Hermes speaking, and he's saying to Asclepius this: "Do you know, Asclepius, that Egypt is an image of heaven? Or to speak more exactly, in Egypt, all the operations of the powers which rule and work in heaven are present in the earth below. In fact, it should be said that the whole cosmos dwells in this our land, as in a sanctuary. And yet, since it is fitting that wise men should have knowledge of all events before they come to pass, you must not be left in ignorance of what I will now tell you. There will come a time when it will have been in vain that Egyptians have honored the Godhead with heartfelt piety and service, and all our holy worship will be fruitless and ineffectual. The gods will return from earth to heaven, Egypt will be forsaken, and the land which was once the home of religion will be left desolate, bereft of the presence of its deities. O Egypt, Egypt, of thy religion nothing will remain but an empty tale, which thine own children in time to come will not believe. Nothing will be left but graven words, and only the stones will tell of thy piety. And in that day men will be weary of life, and they will cease to think the universe worthy of reverent wonder and worship. They will no longer love this world around us, this incomparable work of God, this glorious structure which he has built, this sum of good made up of many diverse forms, this instrument whereby the will of God operates in that which he has made, ungrudgingly favoring man's welfare, this combination and accumulation of all the manifold things that call forth the veneration, praise, and love of the beholder. Darkness will be preferred to light, and death will be thought more profitable than life. No one will raise his eyes to heaven. The pious will be deemed insane, the impious wise. The madman will be thought a brave man, and the wicked will be esteemed as good. As for the soul, and the belief that it is immortal by nature, or may hope to attain to immortality, as I have taught you, all this they will mock, and even persuade themselves that it is false. No word of reverence or piety, no utterance worthy of heaven will be heard or believed. And so the gods will depart from mankind, a grievous thing, and only evil angels will remain, who will mingle with men and drive the poor wretches into all manner of reckless crime, into wars and robberies and frauds and all things hostile to the nature of the soul. Then will the earth tremble, and the sea bear no ships. Heaven will not support the stars in their orbits. All voices of the gods will be forced into silence. The fruits of the earth will rot, the soil will turn barren and the very air will sicken with sullen stagnation. All things will be disordered and awry. All good will disappear. But when all this has befallen Asclepius, then God, the creator of all things, will look on that which has come to pass and will stop the disorder by the counterforce of his will, which is the good. He will call back to the right path those who have gone astray. He will cleanse the world of evil, washing it away with floods, burning it out with the fiercest fire, and expelling it with war and pestilence. And thus he will bring back his world to its former aspect, so that the cosmos will once more be deemed worthy of worship and wondering reverence, and God, the maker and maintainer of the mighty fabric, will be adored by the men of that day with continuous songs of praise and blessing. Such is the new birth of the cosmos. It is a making again of all things good, a holy and awe-inspiring restoration of all nature, and it is wrought inside the process of time by the eternal will of the Creator. I don't know whether we're going to face some terrible global catastrophe or not. I certainly hope not. I hope it will not come down to misery and horror, awful, awful things. There's enough of that in the world already. But I do remember what all the ancient texts say. There isn't a single flood myth, there isn't a single story of the destruction of past civilizations that don't implicate humanity in the story somewhere. Our own behavior, what we do, is part of what we're bringing down on the world right now. What we are manifesting in the world, that is what is coming towards us. We are the authors of this thing, and we can change the story if we want to change it. I firmly believe that. Are we looking at the traces of a forgotten episode in human history? I think so. I think that's what's going on here. And because we've forgotten it, because we are a species with amnesia, because we are so much a mystery to ourselves, perhaps it's because of that that we're so lost and so troubled today, so haunted by the sense of something missing, something that we need to know about ourselves. For the ancient Egyptians, the essential mystery of human existence concerned our spiritual essence, that we are participating in this theater of experience that we call life and the world in an immense endeavor aimed at the perfection of the soul. I've talked with shamans in the Amazon, and when I've asked them, what do you think is the problem with the world? What's the problem with the West? They say it's very simple. You've severed your connection with spirit. You've cut the link, and you have to restore that link if you're going to move forward from here. You can't move forward from the place you're in if you don't restore the connection to spirit. And that seems to me the most fundamental task that all of us now face. Not these exterior trappings of power that have brought such horror and misery to the world. This is the moment of crossroads that we stand at. None of us can effect changes on a macro level. It's impossible to do so. But we can make changes on a micro level. We can make changes in our own lives. We can make changes in our immediate surroundings. Changes for the better. Changes driven by love. So overwhelming is the notion of global destruction. No, I can't stop that, but I can stop what I'm doing to contribute to it. And if we all do that, then I believe a huge change in consciousness will come, and the world can move on, and we can look forward to a future for our children and our children's children, and once again bring this bright, beautiful, jewel garden of a planet, bring it back to the place it should be in our lives.
They know that every day when I'm breathing, it's for us to go farther. You know, every time I speak, I want the truth to come out. You know what I'm saying? Every time I speak, I want to shiver. You know, I don't want them to be like, they know what I'm going to say because it's polite. They know what I'm going to say. I'm not saying I'm going to rule the world or I'm going to change the world, but I guarantee that I will spark the brain that will change the world. And that's our job, is to spark somebody else watching us.